Hi Vidya, welcome to Conversation on the Big Cats. It's wonderful to reconnect. For people who don't know, Vidya and I were together at the Wildlife Institute of India many, many, many moons ago.
Right.
It's been a while. So Vidya, tell me about what you've been doing. And I know you work with leopards and how they struggle for survival amongst humans and all the encroachments that happen on their habitat. So tell me a little more, and we'd love to hear what you have to say about leopards, some of my most favorite cats.
Right. Thanks, Latika. Thanks a lot for inviting me for this. And it was like, it's great that the leopards have made us reconnect after like many lifetimes, I think.
Yes.
That have passed in the middle. Yeah. Yes. And no doubt, the leopards, I think, are many people's favorite animals simply because they have so much character. And I think that is also the reason why they are, you know, so adaptable and can live like anywhere almost. I mean, anywhere in our minds where we don't expect them to be. So I work with WCS India and I've been working with them since 2007. I did my PhD with Dr. Ullas Karan. And I stumbled upon leopards in a human-dominated landscape, like croplands. I didn't expect them to be there. And I went in to study them, not even sure that I'll get any data out of it. And what I found was really fascinating. And it straddles the world of not just animals, but also people. Like, you know, so it's this animal. There's a very nice quote by a geographer called Frederick Landy. And he says how the leopards, you know, flow between the human and natural world with so much ease. And similarly, they make researchers like me, you know, who are only trained in wildlife biology, to also look beyond and see the human dimensions, because that is what the leopards do. So when you follow them, you just, you know, have to see that aspect as well. So yeah, so that is what I've been doing. Yeah,
super. And you know, I think for me the most favorite thing is the way leopards are such thinking cats. You know, a tiger would say, okay guys, I really don't want to know anything about anything out of here. But a leopard, right. You know, you can see the wheels turning and whole thinking happening, which is what makes them so fantastic. So
absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, so tell us something about your leopards.
Yeah, so shall we go on to the presentation?
Absolutely, that'd be great.
Yep. So this is a quintessential leopard in its quintessential habitat, I would say. And this is on the periphery of Bombay. It's, I think it's the largest metropolis in the world in terms of human density. I may be wrong, but even if I am, it can't be more than the first or the second. And we are dealing here with a national park, which is about 100 square kilometers, of forest that were a very old forest. Like, it's forest when Mumbai was still seven islands and wasn't the city of Bombay. But it now today, the density of people that you can see in those, you know, in the human dominated aspect are minimum 20,000 people per square kilometer. And you have the highest density of leopards sharing space with this high density of people. So just to let you know that it's not that the leopards are living in all parts of Bombay, but they definitely are using landscapes that are at the peri-urban part of the metropolis. Yeah. And of course, they live in the rural landscapes where densities of humans is about 400 people per square kilometer, which is crazy by itself. So when I started working on them like two decades back, the dominant narrative was man-eaters and, you know, they attack for no reason and, you know, menace and that trap, removing them when you didn't want them there, leaving them in a forest, you know, was a good thing to do. So that was where I came from. And they are large cats, which, you know, all of them are really, really secretive. Leopard is the most adaptable large cat, which is why it occurs from the desert regions to the snow-clad regions in the Russian Far East. And here you can see it, it's hunting in our building lobby at the edge of Mumbai. And the building people will tell, at the edge of the Sanjay Gandhi National Park in Mumbai, and the building people will tell you that, you know, this is a sixth dog that's gone from their lobby. And another very important thing is that we have made our boundaries of protected areas, and the leopards do not follow them. They don't follow us people nor our boundaries. So why do they attack people? You know, if you ask me, I really don't know. And the only narrative we have about leopard attacks on people are from hunters' tales. And I don't think that's a right way of looking at it, okay? And attacks on people are much rarer than other kind of interactions these animals have with people. And if you ask me, our study which showed that large-scale translocation of leopards actually causes human attacks near the release sites, I believe it has something to do with stress of the translocation and, you know, aggression related to this. So this is just to show you, it's a night vision imagery of a bench. You know, he's lying upside down here in Aray Mill Colony adjoining the National Park in Bombay. And in the daytime, people are sitting on the benches, and in the night, the leopard is happily, you know, upside down on it, belly up. This is, you know, where I work, this kind of landscape, which has no forest, entirely agricultural. The hills in the background are bare. I think during the British time, the trees were all taken away for timber for the railway sleepers. Yeah. So there were very large number of attacks in this valley called Junnar between 2001 and 2002, and then in Mumbai between 2004 and 2005. So the agricultural landscape, this is a satellite, a Google Earth image, and you can see that every bit of land is, you know, it's a fertile land, it's irrigated, it's crops are grown on it. And all these produce are usually go to Bombay, Pune, Nashik. So they get a good amount for their produce. So just to let you know that these are the this whole landscape that you see on the westernmost part is Bombay near the sea. And you can see this large green tract in the middle of the image. And one would think, oh, it's probably, you know, a forested area, but it's actually the irrigated valley of the river Godavari. And you can just, the yellow markers that I have put are all the natural forests of that region. And you can see how patchy and little they are. And this is the northernmost part of the Western Ghats, where it becomes really, really tiny fragments, and you can see how big and contiguous the irrigated landscape is. So long back in 2003 and 2004, a lot of leopards were being caught in the croplands, which you just saw the, you know, extent of. And what we were doing is that I was working with a wildlife veterinarian, Dr. Belsere, who was putting microchip in these leopards before they were translocated. And what we found is that two things. One is that majority of the animals were captured only because they were seen and not because they had created a problem. And they were living in this landscape, not doing anything. We also found on microchipping that, you know, conflict is transferred to another site. Like, for instance, this female was captured in the southern circle, like where you see the circle, and she was released close to the border of Madhya Pradesh. And after a few months, where you see the star, which is about 70 kilometers from the site of release, there were attacks on people for the first time in the history of the place. And when they caught her again, it was found to be this female, and she was in perfect condition. Her teeth were all fine. She was not injured. So their COVID theory breaks down. We found she was a translocated animal. She had a microchip from the time that she was caught down in Junnar, where the red circle is. And now she's back in the rescue center for lifetime captivity. So I started and tried to understand when we found so many animals, majority of the animals are being caught because they're just seen and not done anything. I was really curious to find out how they live among such high densities of people, which is like minimum of 400 people per square kilometer, and in a landscape that's so modified like this. So we started putting up camera traps, and you can see this village on the right hand side and all the green agricultural crops, and the red place mark is where we put our camera traps, and we got two different leopards there, like, you know, within 50-100 meters of the village. And it's a bit hard to explain, but you know, right in the center is the valley where I worked in. I mean, my cursor, I'm doing this on the phone, so this is just to show you that where I'm going to talk about, like, which is the place I'm going to talk about now. Again, very close to town, we put up camera traps and we got leopards here. You can see the yellow place mark, and you can see it's like, you know, almost right next to our house, and we got leopards there and other species as well. And these women had no clue that the sugarcane behind them, about 60 meters away, you know, our collared leopard was, that was her day bed. She would sit there all day, and these giggly women were planting onions, and they had no clue that these animals are so close by. Like, and we got a lot of leopards. We got like 5 adult leopards in 100 square kilometers. Big animals, females. This is a cub, and this is mother and cub in the foggy. So mother and cub indicates that they are resident, because no mother and cub is going to be floating around, you know. She uses the best part of her territory when she has her cubs. And a hell of a lot of people. This was like 10 years back, so people didn't have much entertainment then. I think 24/7 news had just about begun. So for them, this camera trap was pretty much very interesting to have a look at. And in the same time that the leopards used to come, people used to come from a kilometer or two away to look at the camera traps. And we got huge number of exposure of people. Like, we got some 81 images of leopards, but we got some 1800 images of people. Yeah, you can just scroll. And some of them were really funny. They would come and pose in front of the camera traps. I mean, not just little kids like these, but in the next pictures, you'll see that even the older ladies and her husband too, in the next picture, which was really hilarious for us. We also got hyenas at the same density as leopards, 5 hyenas in 100 square kilometers. So that's 10 large carnivores in 100 square kilometers, and jungle cats. Rusty spotted cats breeding. So this is, I think, a female, because another time we got a cub also with her. And you can see why. Because the croplands are full of prey for these animals in terms of rodents. So it's actually a rich landscape if there is no full-time persecution and full-time killing of these animals. Jackals we got. So I did not expect at all to find so many leopards. I did not expect to find, you know, other carnivores like hyenas. And what about conflict? What about attacks on people? I was really scared when I started working there, because, you know, sugarcane is higher than you, and, you know, I was a bit scared. But in this landscape that I worked in, Akole, there had never been human deaths ever due to leopards. There are no wild herbivores here. The density of cattle, sheep and goat are extremely high. Dogs, very, very high. And we found that the diet was mainly livestock and domestic animals, forming more than 80%, and especially the dogs. So just the density of own dogs. See, the density of human beings in India is so much that even if 1/4 of those people own dogs, that would still be a hell of a lot of dogs in the landscape. So in this particular valley, there were, not much conflict happening there, even in terms of the way people responded to the leopards. And this is a very common part of that entire, I mean, it's an old video, but it's just incredible because it shows how crazy these animals are. So these are percolation wells that are dug up all over the landscape, because when the river water is left from the dam, it fills in these percolation wells. And the people are standing on top looking down. They usually don't have any railings because nobody really uses the well. And you can see at the back, it's onion fields, and beyond that, it's maize fields. And the people are curious. Nobody is like aggressive, and nobody is, you know, wanting to kill the leopard. They just all want to look at it. And majority of the time, they are no different than us. They are fascinated by these animals. They want to have a look at it. It's only when it's badly managed that that fascination turns into a mob. And that's where we need to be careful how we deal with these situations. So the forest department has set a trap cage, and they put a leopard, a ladder. And he climbs up the ladder. And he turns and looks at the camera after this. I have no idea why. And then he's on his way. So, and he goes and hides in the maze, and nobody is going to go after him there. So this is what's done every couple of weeks. There's one incident like this that happens. So we collared some leopards in this landscape, and this is one of the female we collared. She had young ones as well. She had a sub-adult son also who we collared, and she had another litter after that, but we just got to know because we had collared her. She's buried a domestic pig behind that arch. Yeah, so this is a satellite image of her points that we got from her GPS collar over a year. And you can see that this was her land, this was where she lived. So when you zoom in, you can see that, you know, you can see her locations, and that town was a town of 10,000 people. You know, the animals that we had collared, we captured them, released them there in Akole, and they lived there for the year. And we collared two other Maharashtra animals who were caught in one place and released somewhere else. Like this animal with the pink dots, for instance, she was caught on the top and she was released at a release site right at the bottom, the last, you know, pink spot. And she lived near the release site for a while, because I think she was pregnant when we collared her, and I think she probably gave birth to her young ones because she was quite, you know, pretty seriously pregnant. And after 4 months, she walked back that 60 kilometers in 1 week and went back home, and she lived there for the remaining 8 months till the collar dropped. So just to indicate that we may think that these animals need to be released here and they will live here, but they never listen to what we want them to do. Yeah. So this is the two animals, the mother that I showed you a picture of and a sub-adult son, and they were caught here and released here, and this was their home range. They just lived here for that entire year that we got data from. Like the one of them is blue markers and the other is a green markers. So according to their point of view, this is their home, and according to the 10,000 people who lived in that town, it was their home. So, you know, whose space is it and whose idea of space is it is my question. So this guy, you know, was a really interesting animal. He chased a dog and the dog fell in the well and the leopard fell behind him. And they managed to get the dog out, but apparently he died the next day, and it came in the newspaper that he died from a heart attack because they were sharing the same ledge. But we collared this leopard, and he was released on the where the eastern, you know, you can see the yellow point starting. That is where he was released, and we thought he will live there. Now, that was an area with forests and low human density. But he just started walking, and he walked to Mumbai. Like in 25 days, he walked 125 kilometers, crossed a major national highway, crossed a railway station, crossed two wildlife sanctuaries. But he didn't want to live there. He just went straight to Sanjay Gandhi National Park in Bombay. And you can see the red point between the two roads, that he was in an industrial estate near Bombay for a night, for one point. He swam this creek, went into the main park, and he swam back. And like about this distance, which is 100 meters or more, next to. So, you know, again, his name was Azoba. And because he did such a spectacular feat, or so people thought, there was an entire Marathi feature film made on the leopard, which is fascinating. And it also goes to show that people have a lot of space in their hearts for these animals, even if they are leopards. It's how do we as catalysts ensure that that space is made for them. And I also realized while working that humans have also adapted to the presence of the leopards in their landscape. So when I interviewed, I found that more than 70% of the farmers have made their livestock sheds predator proof. There are traditional ways also of dealing with leopards, like really old, and one is the use of dogs, but leopards also eat dogs, so, and they go for the neck. So the, you know, these collars like this are used to keep away the leopards from killing their dogs. And shepherds often use dogs as early warning systems. So this idea of wild that we have, there's a very interesting essay by Cronin. I think it's a pretty old one, 1970s sometime. And it's a must read. Okay, I think it's The Idea of Wilderness or something is the name, but the idea of wild is a cultural construct. There's no way my grandfather and grandmom would have gone into a forest to see a tiger, because they belong to a generation where forests were dangerous as hell, you know. But now it's routine, like we all go into the forest to see tigers. So, and it's everything just from our perspective, like, you know, protected areas are made by people for human administrative use. The animals have no idea of their boundaries. The boundaries exist where wild animals, on stepping out of these boundaries, are always killed. Like in Africa and in the US and stuff, you know, if a mountain lion comes and eats your livestock or domestic animals, the farmer is totally allowed to kill it. And when such things happen, then they don't exist outside. But in India, you cannot do that. And therefore, the boundaries, the animals don't follow. I think you need to go back because I'm... Yeah, and also different people have different ideas of where the animals should be. You ask an indigenous person and they're like, yeah, they're around us. So it's kind of interesting because when I started working in this landscape, I was largely working with the local forest department. For them, leopards were a normal everyday existence and they knew about it. You know, but I would go back and I would talk to my colleagues and people from the city and all, and they were like, no way, it can't be. You know, so it depends who you're talking to and what their idea is of where the wild is. And I don't think anybody's ever asked a leopard what its idea is of, you know, where its space should be. And I think it's really important that we look at things from these animals' perspectives, especially if we're going to use it in affecting policy. Like, you cannot make corridors without understanding if animals are going to use it or not. Just a green landscape is not going to be a corridor for the animals, because leopards use agricultural fields in the night. One tigress we collared outside Tadoba, she was using agricultural fields in the night. For her, it was fine, because in the nighttime, rural India, people are all asleep and it's almost like a wild space for the wild animals there. And that's what our telemetry results found out, that the wild animals use human landscapes only in the night when people usage is very, very low. And trapping and removal does not help, because if you remove one animal, it opens up space for other animals to come in. So it doesn't help. And our law does not allow killing, and our culture will not allow for culling. So it's a complicated issue. And rural people, I mean, you have to realize Indian civilizations are really, really old, especially these landscapes I'm talking about. People have lived in them for thousands of years. Leopards and hyenas, societies have lived in them for, you know, tens of thousands of years. And these are old shared landscapes where both people and wildlife, I believe, have co-adapted to share space with each other. And just to let you all know, like, you know, if you look at the Earth's land mammals by weight, you can just see how human beings, which is, I think, the central dark gray bit, the light gray is all their livestock, and the green blotches at the corners are wild animals. So essentially, human landscapes are full of livestock occurring at such great densities, which no protected area in India will be able to match. The average, next please, I think I have it written there. Like, the average cattle and sheep and goat density per square kilometer in India is about 150. And you can imagine a leopard sitting on that hill watching all this and saying, oh my God, so much of food to eat, right? So it's not an issue about carrying capacity, I believe. Like earlier, they would say, oh, there's no food outside. That's why, you know, they are in, you know, no food in the forest. That's why these animals are coming outside. There's no way any protected area will be able to match the kind of livestock density India has. We have more domestic animals and human beings in our country, yeah, and it's always been like that. We are pastoralists, and you know, livestock's been a part of our life, and in any human society, it's been part of our life. And protected areas are just 5% of our land area. All the red blotches that you see are our protected areas. If wild animals had to be only within them, majority of our wild animals would be extinct just because of inbreeding. But wild animals have learned to adapt. And that is just the theory of evolution. So they have adapted, and they have adapted to human-used landscapes, I believe. And is this an Indian phenomenon? It isn't. In many parts of Europe and US, especially in the urban landscapes, you have wildlife like coyotes and, you know, bears, as well as in the US. Mountain lions, again, another very adaptable cat. So, you know, urban carnivores are there many places. So India is got a lot of people. It's also got a lot of livestock. It's also got a hell of a lot of large wildlife. It's got the only population of the Asiatic lion in the world, which is increasing. And it's amazing for me, you know, to see that. We've got the largest global population of the Bengal tiger. We've got the largest global population of the Asiatic elephants, when countries with far fewer people and more forests don't have it. And except for the cheetah, we pretty much have all our large wildlife still today, which is like incredible. And there's a lot of cultural inclusion of wildlife in our mind space, you know. Like, for instance, I remember this story of Narasimha, you know, the half lion, half human being kind of, like, you know, but you can see the little child at the side, you know, and it's not a picture of aggression, it's not a picture of predation. It is a fluid, you know, space between humans, wildlife, culture, myth, stories, you know. And I think that is really important, because it's not only fear that we are looking at these animals with. Like, my very first thought of a tiger was the story that I read where, you know, this tigress, this little boy, Ayyappan, he comes back to his village sitting on a tigress. So there was no negative connotation there, you know. So I think it's important how we see these animals. And then what we also figured is that there are many communities who have different relationships with these animals. Like, there are some who revere, out of respect and fear, the large cats in like Maharashtra, Gujarat. They call the deity Vagoba. And you can see that in Bombay, you have the Varlis who revere the leopard as a protector of the forests and things like that. And it's also seen in Ethiopia. You can see these hyenas which can otherwise kill a person. But in this church complex, you know, they are also seen, I think, as animals of the god, and they are fed by people. And so there are these different relationships that different groups of people have with these animals that is not always rooted in fear. Different people have different reaction to wild animals. It's not necessarily, I am not talking about a harmonious coexistence, nor am I talking about, like, you know, the leopards wanting to kill people and people wanting to kill the leopards. But it's, to me, it's just like how people in a city have relationship with the dogs. Some of them like them, some of them don't like them, and there's a whole lot who don't care what is happening, you know. And it's no different for me for that. So I am just going to show you a short 7-minute video on how we turned around the serious conflict of Mumbai. And this was a partnership. It was initiated by a very wildlife-friendly forest officer who was very, very dynamic and got everybody on board, Mr. LeMay. He started it in 2011, and even a decade down the line, the project still continues, although he is not actively in charge anymore, nor am I actively involved anymore. But the citizens of Bombay, the media of Bombay, are carrying it on their shoulders in collaboration with the forest department. And I think that's a great story, and a lot of generalities to be taken from it, which hopefully we have highlighted in the movie. And I'm just going to...
Dawn unfurls a bustle of activity in Mumbai, a global city that attracts millions in search of fame and fortune. There's another face to India's financial capital. Shadowed by popular impressions, an island of ancient forests thrives within the heart of Mumbai. Sanjay Gandhi National Park. 100 square kilometer treasure trove of India's natural heritage, SGNP represents the greener extreme of Mumbai. But with 35 leopards in this oasis, surrounded by massive urban sprawl supporting around 21,000 people per square kilometer, leopard-human interactions are inevitable. In the past, fear prevailed over reason, and leopards were blindly branded villains, captured and relocated, until scientists discovered that it did more harm than good. Now, backed with scientific understanding and best traditional practices, a people's movement is taking shape. Mumbai is pioneering in our ever-shrinking world the art of coexisting peacefully with this adaptable predator. In a small hamlet inside SGNP, members of the indigenous Wali tribe prepare for their day. They have been living with leopards for as long as they can remember.
Vagoba matlab hamare gaon ka rakhanda hai, wo gaon mein archan aata hai na, wo raksha karta hai, aisa hum log uska puja karte hain, hamara gaon ka dev.
What about their god lifting their poultry and livestock?
Bhook lagegi to leke jayega hai na, apan kaisa bhook lagegi to khana kabhi denge ghar pe, aisa chillate hai na, aisa hai.
Yet, they understand the potential risks and take precautions to keep themselves and their children safe. Not everyone is lucky to understand leopards as these tribes do. residents outside SGNP panicked at even just the sighting. Enter Mumbikers for SGNP, a multi-dimension initiative to mitigate conflicts and help people live with leopards.
That initiative came into being when the Forest Department and some of the researchers, scientists and the passionate volunteers decided to come together, study the whole scenario and then try to mitigate one by one all those issues.
It was not an easy task. People's mindsets had to be changed from fear to understanding leopards. But with precedents set by tribes like Warlies, success was only a matter of time and approach. The Forest Department and Mumbikers set about on four interconnected activities. The first was scientific research to understand leopards, their prey, and interactions with people. Among other findings, the research revealed reasons for leopard presence outside the forest.
So usually the park would be blamed, you know, like there's not enough prey in your park and there's a reason the leopards are coming out. I used line transects, distance sampling, to know the prey density. There was adequate prey. The only thing was there was more than adequate prey outside the park in terms of pigs, dogs majorly.
The second activity was to build capacity of the Forest Department. Rescue team members were sensitized, trained and equipped for immediate response to leopard incidences, including tranquilization when necessary. Improved coordination between different divisions of the Forest Department ensured that all emergencies were effectively attended. The third activity was to develop constructive partnerships. Coordination with the municipal corporation to provide facilities like street lights and public toilets and to effectively manage garbage that attracts stray dogs was one. Sensitization of the police force was another priority to aid in mob control during leopard emergencies. Workshops were also held for the media to restrict sensationalism. With their reach, journalists played a crucial role in helping people understand leopards by disseminating scientifically backed information.
The whole journey from sensational to sensibility has been a long one. There was this program that started Mumbikers for SGNP. That is somewhere what changed the whole way of reportage. Forest Department became accessible to the media. Immediately, the level of sensationalism dropped.
The fourth activity was to engage a wide range of public through awareness sessions on do's and don'ts during leopard sightings to prevent any mishaps.
What we are trying to do is go ahead and meet these people before an incident. Speak to them and tell them this could happen in the future. To avoid that from happening, what can you do?
Many residents now accept leopards as neighbors. They take active precautions to reduce risk for themselves and advocate for others to do the same.
जितने मौत रोड एक्सीडेंट में हुई है वो लेपर्ड में अटैक में ऐसा कुछ भी नहीं हुआ है लेपर्ड आए तो कोई भी घबरा मत जाइए उसको उसके राह से जाने दीजिए उसको डिस्टर्ब मत कीजिए उसको वहां पे शोर मत मचाइए सिर्फ वहां से हट जाइए
With the residents being sensitized by the project, no leopards have been captured in Mumbai since 2013. And when left alone, leopards, following their natural instinct, avoid people. No attacks on humans have been reported in the last 2 years in and around SGNP, as against up to 30 attacks a year between 2003 and 2005.
Now the situation is gradually changing, the mindset is gradually changing. It's a big achievement.
Mumbai has come a long way from experiencing severe conflicts to finding solutions for peaceful coexistence. This was possible because general citizens were part of it, realizing the values the park adds in their urban lives.
In this ecosystem where we are staying, if the wildlife goes away, our existence will also be threatened.
Thankfully, an increasing number of citizens are now working towards positive change. This may be about saving India's natural heritage, but interconnected as we all are, begins with saving one life.
One of the rescue department guys told me a very good statement. He saying, sir, आप लोग इतना अच्छा काम कर रहे हैं इसमें से सिर्फ एक बच्चे की भी जान बच गई तो अपना जो उद्देश्य है वो सक्सेसफुल हो गया
Great. Okay, so I mean, a lot of, you know, this conversation, especially when you talked about the moving of the leopard and stress causing him to turn antagonistic towards humans is interesting, but can you tell us a little more about what is happening in that whole Chandrapur belt? Because we keep hearing these horror stories, true conflict. For the most part, it's space sharing. But that area seems to have true conflict.
Yeah. But see, the thing is, I don't work there. But what I can tell you is that, you know, from my experience, if there is conflict, that means you're not doing things right. Because if you do things right, which the Bombay example shows, and many other, like, you know, we've been working in Tehri in Uttarakhand, and even Himachal shows that conflict actually can decrease if you do the right thing. So I think a lot of the focus in majority of the conflict studies is targeted at the animal, understanding the ecology of the animal. But that doesn't help in a conflict situation, because it is the people's issues that are more important. You know, what were they doing out there? Why is the antagonistic interaction happening? You know, and like, for instance, in Bombay and Junnar, we figured that this capture release was actually worsening the problem. It may not be the same everywhere. Different places may have different triggers for the conflict. But to reduce that, then we knew that once we reduce this, the conflict's going to reduce, which happened. But it was, the solutions were at the people, which you saw in the movie, you know, that So the solutions are targeted at the people, then it helps. So it's very important that people like us who are studying the animals realize that the solutions are in the domain of the people and not in the domain of the animal. So if there is a conflict, then that means you're not doing the targeted work at the domain of the people.
So now, you know, it's interesting that you talk about stress, and we're talking about an real increase in development projects across the country. Obviously, there is stress when there's huge, mechanisms and machines in the area and this huge change happening to everything. But does the stress actually continue with an increase in, you know, human activity in vehicle movement? We were talking about underpasses and, you know, all of that. Does that actually add to the stress? Is that, has anything been done on that?
No, not with the large cats as far as I know, but there was a researcher who studied the stress through corticosteroids in the elephants that were using human-used landscapes. And what he found, I think, was only when... But these were not landscapes where there was, like, you know, such rapid changes that we are seeing. So I don't think we can really comment on that, because we really don't know, you know. But I'm sure, if not of that, like, the linear infrastructure and all is killing a hell of a lot of these animals. So I think it's important. I don't know, you know, in foreign countries, you see that the planning is done based on the requirement. So if you have a larger density of vehicles using the landscape, then you go ahead and you make a new road or you broaden your road. I don't see that kind of planning here. So it's not that there is more traffic and therefore you need to make, you know, a six-lane highway. It's just that you need to make a six-lane highway. And I think somewhere we need to rationalize, you know, doing these things.
Okay. Yeah. So, you know, India is known as the land of the tiger. If you compare us with many of our neighbors and much of the world, actually, we have a huge leopard population as well. And I think somewhere the leopard poor thing has got overshadowed by the tiger.
Right.
You know, it's a sad situation, because the Asiatic lion has got the attention because it's rare. The snow leopard has got the because it's up there and not visible to everyone. Right. And the poor leopard, who's like hanging around and everywhere, is sort of, you know, sitting around waiting for someone to give it some love and care and attention. So what is being done to actually, you know, in Mumbai now, because of all these stories and the films and all of this, there's an attitude change and people are actually excited about living with the leopards. But what is happening in the rest of the country? Is anybody doing work like that?
So there are a lot of, I think, small projects happening here and there where people are studying the leopards. See, it's also really difficult to get funds for studying leopards in human-dominated landscape because the money is like, oh, we need to give it to the tiger, you know, which is much more endangered. And human-dominated landscape, like, who wants to, you know? So it's also an issue of getting funded for these kind of projects. Like a student of mine, for instance, went in to the tea gardens of West Bengal to study leopards. He just wasn't getting funds, and he was, anyway, there was a serious problem with elephants. So he started also looking at that because the elephants were killing a lot more people, whereas leopards were just injuring. But the moment he had elephants, like, it was much easier for him to get funds. So I think that's a big problem as well, getting funds for the species.
So yeah. When you're looking at funds, Vidya, just to get an idea, what is the length of the projects normally, and what is the sort of funding that you get? Is it normally from Indians, or do you have to go to people abroad? How do you get your funding? How does it work?
So the largest funding that I got was for this research work that I showed you, that I was lucky enough to get the Kaplan Fellowship. That was really long back, 10 years back. And then there was this Norwegian project which came to Indian Institute of Science, Dr. Sukumar's lab, and he gave me the money. So all the telemetry was done via him. But after that, like, it has been difficult to get funding. You know, we got funded by the Himachal Pradesh Forest Department, and we did, you know, trying to assess the conflict patterns. And the student of mine who's working in West Bengal, Arithro Shetty, he's got government funding. So it is not a, it's, I want to say I wish I were working on tigers, because I think leopards taught me a lot and I'm grateful for that. But I just wish the leopard were, you know, got a bit more attention than it did.
Okay, so maybe this is a good thing to suggest, that the next mascot for India should be a leopard.
I don't mind it at all, because, I think it has so much more to tell us about shared spaces, which is something like in the Anthropocene, you're just going to have more and more shared spaces in urban landscapes or wherever, and this animal is actually showing us how it can be done, and we really need to understand more about shared spaces.
Yeah. Okay, so another thing that comes to mind is, how does climate change and global warming affect the leopard, as you know? Mumbai is, you know, a hot center for all of this, so just looking at your study area.
No, so the thing is that my study area didn't have any leopards in the 1970s, because it was a semi-arid landscape which didn't have irrigation. The villagers were not allowed to use the river water for irrigation. And around the 80s that changed, the politician who came made it such that the farmers can use. So the landscape, so earlier there were wolves and semi-arid, you know, nilgiris and stuff like that. But the moment, it's like now sugarcane on largely and other cash crops and stuff like that. The wolves left and the leopards have come. So it's really hard for me to say anything, because, you know, especially in the rural landscapes, everything is just so changing so fast. You know, I don't know. I can't make a judgment on that. Yeah.
I can live with that. That's right. Okay. So I really also wanted to understand from you. We've seen in your research, you've seen that the tiger and the lion have both been a very important part of culture here. Have you actually come across incidents of the leopards being?
Yeah. So the leopard is also considered by a lot of the rural people, like in Uttarakhand and Himachal and all, although it's the tiger that the goddess sits on as a vehicle, they also consider the leopard to be the same. They don't see that much of a difference. So I've heard from forest officers when a leopard has died and all, like in the northern hill states, that the ladies will come and put vermilion on the dead leopard and put flowers and all, because it's the goddess's vahan. So that is, it is there in the cultural this. On the flip side of it, like the although the goddess protects you, even apparently the leopard is seen as a protector. But that has its negative connotations because its claws are often worn to protect the person. So there is a cultural space it occupies. And in, Vidarbha, in Goa, in Maharashtra and Gujarat, they worship Vagoba, which is both the tiger and the leopard. I don't think the rural people see that much of a difference that we see between the tiger and the leopard. For them, it's just a large cat.
Okay. So one interesting point which you brought up again and again and again while you were talking was the fact that big cats use agricultural spaces and human habitation and human landscapes at night because disturbance is less. So have you found that this has changed during the 3 months of lockdown? Have you had any news, any feedback?
I don't know. I don't think rural landscapes are that much locked down like our urban landscapes. But I really don't know because I'm under lockdown too.
So here in Udaipur, we have this wonderful little leopard with two cubs. And right? She decided to hang out in the palaces for the lockdown.
Wow,
and
okay.
So she was inside the city palace. And she was in all of the hotels. She's been from the Leela to the Uday Villas to the Trident. And she this is her belt. And she's been going around. And they actually, there were some people in the city palace who got freaked out. And they she was right inside. And they had to actually take her and put her outside again. But a few days later, she was back,
Right.
So we've been seeing her in the day as well, which is... a nice change, but as well, I know what you're talking about, and it's peaceful.
Right. That's cool.
So, Vidya, last thing that I think would be really interesting for everybody who's going to watch this talk is, do you have a list of recommendations for what people should do when they actually come face to face with a leopard, in the place that they are? And I know panicking is not on that list.
Right.
So can you tell
us? Definitely. So see, the thing is that wild animals are more scared of human beings, which is something all of us know, biologists who have worked on them. Yeah. And if you look at it from the large cat's point of view, we are actually their predator, right? We kill them in the most numbers and we kill for no reason most of the time. And I think they know that. So they really keep away from us. So we recommend that. And it's not just us. Like we even took, the do's and don'ts that the indigenous people use in Mumbai. And it's very similar to what we say, which is like, their hours are usually the dark hours. So don't send your kids out alone at that time. Okay. And if you have to go, especially in the rural landscapes where, not many people, dark, leopards. Then every day, everybody has a mobile, just play some song and go, because you're creating, you're informing the animal that, human beings are coming. And there are many videos and many photographs which show how they immediately hide at the side of the road, and you'll cross them and go as well. We don't know they're there, but they move away when they know we are coming. So it's really important you announce your walking through their landscape. And another very important thing in peri-urban and urban areas is that make sure you don't have any garbage nearby, because the garbage attracts dogs and pigs and large rodents, and then the leopards come behind them. So it's a very important measure that you need to take. Keep your surroundings clean and you won't have a problem with them.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for talking. This has been so good. You do a connect maybe a whole group of us sometime. Thank you, Vidya. That's
You're welcome. Awesome. Thanks for calling.
Thanks, Vidya. Bye.
Bye.
there was a school community from Switzerland that had come in, and they wanted to work with the school children, you know, build things for them and everything.